I'd like to introduce you to Sonia. She is a rising star in her industry and her profession. She's known to be passionate, personable, innovative. She has grit and she's tenacious. People would say she's a badass in a good way, right? The fact is, though, she is battling this silent tempest, and that is ADHD, inattentive subtype. She's on a first-name basis, actually pretty close friends with procrastination, and she has this whirlwind of thoughts constantly going in her mind. And that leads her to jump from being distracted to sometimes hyper-focused. And the thing is, if you dive even a layer deeper, there are times where she just feels like a fraud. She thinks she's gotten to where she is based on luck, and she wonders when her luck is going to run out. I am Sonia. At any given moment, I have this whirlwind, this cacophony of thoughts going on in my mind. It is like having 18 chaotic squirrels running around, being chased by 30 energetic and barking dogs. And in case you're wondering, I did try to name them. I stopped around 5 or 6 with Clyde and Clovis. It was just too much. I couldn't keep track of them. Now, the fact is, I'm not alone. In fact, 50% of women with ADHD are undiagnosed. That means 6 million women in the US and 135 million worldwide have ADHD and don't know it. Reason for this is most women present with the inattentive subtype, while boys, men, tend to present with the hyperactive subtype. They get noticed earlier, usually in school years. They get some support, some coaching, therapy, maybe even medication. Women, girls, present with the inattentive subtype. Often, those symptoms get overlooked, misattributed, misdiagnosed. Those girls and women start to wonder, what's wrong with me? Why is it so hard? Why am I having this problem in focusing? Why can't I remember people's names right after they tell me? Why is it difficult to follow directions and instructions? And they start to internalize. The fact is, there is a lot we can do to support these women. And we need to change the narrative around how we talk about our brains and how they work. I want to say it's great what we're doing in terms of neurodiversity. We've taken strides, but you know what? We're missing the freaking mark. We still say that someone is neurodivergent. Within ADHD, it's disorder, right? You're not of the norm, you're outside of the norm. So when you have someone who's already putting labels on themselves, like I'm abnormal, I'm damaged, I'm less than, and then you have society putting those labels, it's a lot, it's not kind. What I would like to do is challenge the narrative. What we know about the brain today, it's still young, right? That research, that knowledge is early on. And if we think of about a parallel, think about intelligence, just for a second. We used to measure intelligence simply based on IQ. Well, there's been a renaissance. We no longer just measure on intelligence, that intelligent quotient. We have additional dimensions. We now measure on emotional intelligence, EQ. We measure adaptability, AQ, right? We've evolved, so our understanding of the brain should evolve too. What I'd like to propose is that we each have a unique cognitive fingerprint. There is no normal. And with that, there is a philosophy I would like to introduce to this audience, and that is neurocuriosity. We need to be curious about how our brains work. We need to understand when we show up the best for ourselves and make space for that. That's what neurocuriosity is about. It's not about judgment. It is about recognizing your superpowers, neurological superpowers, because we each have them. Now, me, when I am trying to quiet those squirrels, quiet those dogs, I found an interesting ally, kind of surprising to me, and that is AI, artificial intelligence. I specifically like ChatGPT, some Gen AI tools. For me, what's so great about these tools is that they aggregate all this information together. They simplify it. So rather than me going out online searching and being distracted by this and following the next link and just getting lost in a whirlwind of information, I have these great tools that can aggregate and simplify the information for me. And it quiets the noise. The other thing it does is just help me day to day. I use it to craft emails, draft strategies. I ask it to help me learn a new language. It's amazing what you can do. And you have them in your pocket, all these tools. I have my phone with me right now. I have the ChatGPT app on my phone. It's kind of like having a tech sidekick, like I'm a superhero. I have Alfred from Batman, or I have Q from James Bond, right? It's pretty cool. And the thing is, you don't have to be intimidated about artificial intelligence and these Gen AI tools. We already use them every day. How many times have you said, hey, Alexa, what is the temperature outside? Hey, Google, tell me where the closest Thai restaurant is. Siri, please send a message to. All of that is artificial intelligence. So when you think about ChatGPT, you don't have to be nervous about it. In fact, it's a conversation. All you have to say is, hey, ChatGPT, I'm a TEDx speaker, and I would like 6 statistics about ADHD from credible sources within the last 2 to 3 years. Please make sure to include the URLs for each of those sources. That's it. It is that easy. Now, here's the flip side. All these tools consume data, right? Data is the food for artificial intelligence. And so that means we need to be aware of what we are feeding into this ecosystem. It is all of our prompts, all of our queries, all of our personal, professional information, banking, health, all of that is going in to this vast tapestry of data that feeds artificial intelligence. And it's up to us to know what is being done with that data. We've made some great strides, but there's a lot that needs to be done. Here's a scary statistic. Last year, there were over 1,800 data breaches just in the United States. That affected 422 million individuals. That's a crap ton, right? That worries me. We've made strides. We have in Europe GDPR, which is about data control, and we also have in California CCPA, which is about data protection. We also have a historic moment that occurred last week, October 30th, 2023, where Biden signed the executive order on, hang on a second, it's long, the safe, secure, trustworthy development and use of artificial intelligence. Now, I wrote that on my hand last night because I thought I wouldn't remember it. And it was like 4 freaking fingers. So I'm pretty impressed that I remembered it. What's great about this order, though, is it's a framework, a vision to where we can get to ethical AI. And what it does is say, hey, we are going to start actively working as a collective towards data protection and privacy. We're going to also institute and work towards equity and equality. We're also going to protect consumers and workers. And guess what? We still want to foster competition and innovation. So it is a great framework that we can build upon to get to an ethical AI future. I've talked about a lot. And probably, like, you have a question like, wait a second, she talked about ADHD, she talked about AI, and now she's talking about data. How does it connect? Well, what I propose is that we replace judgment with inquisitiveness, which is where neurocuriosity comes in. We replace fear with empowerment, which is where AI comes in. And then we harness the power of neurocuriosity along with AI. And what we do then is we build that future where we're bringing our superpowers to the forefront, right? We're using tools to empower where we bring our best selves. And we're using data, but our data is also safe and secure. There's a couple things we can all do in terms of making this future a reality and making that executive order one that we can really live with in harmony with AI, that ethical AI goal. The first is to be neurocurious, right? Dive in, learn how your brain works. Make sure you discover your superpowers and provide space for other people to do that. It's not about divergence. It's not about being different. It is your unique cognitive fingerprint. The second is to be informed. Look into data reports, data transparency, learn what data is collected and how it's being used. Dive into AI. It's not that difficult, and again, you have the devices in your pockets. It's with you all the time. Explore. Go beyond just ChatGPT. Go beyond Siri. Go beyond your typical digital assistant. Explore. Have fun. You're not going to break anything. Then what I would also urge you to do is join the conversation. Talk to your friends. Talk to your colleagues. Understand how they're using AI. Also understand what struggles they're facing and how they're coping and building themselves up. And then the last step is to foster and advocate for ethical AI. And this means building collective action, working together to influence policies so that we do achieve that future. And with that, what I want to say is that I am with you, along with all of my chaotic squirrels and dogs, and a dash of AI. Thank you.